In that name that is above every name, for the Bible declares that at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow and every tongue must confess that he is Lord. Good morning, Second Mount Zion, and our Facebook family, and to the global world. How blessed we are once again, as we are a part of God's agenda for the day. And if you woke up this morning, you are a part of God's agenda, and we are glad and delighted to be here on this wonderful Lord's Day. And what a good day it is. God just knows exactly what we need. And so at this time, Deacon Simpson is going to come now with our church school lesson, and we ask that you would give him your undivided attention at this time, Deacon Simpson.
Good morning to my Second Mount Zion Church family, both near and abroad. Bow with me for a moment of prayer. Our Father, our God, we thank you now for this hour that you have set before us. We pray now, Lord, that these words would be meet to someone, O Lord. We pray now, Lord, that you would guide us and strengthen us in these trying times. But it is through your word that we will learn and we will be able to discern wisdom. So go with us now and stand with us right now, Lord. These are all the things we ask in your son, Christ Jesus. We say amen.
Amen.
And good morning again to everyone. What a beautiful day it is. It's good to see everybody, even though you see me. I can't really see you, but thank you. And even though I can't see you right now, we ask that you would participate with the comment section, that you would write your questions out, that you would give us a thumbs up. Let's see the hearts go up. While we're on Facebook. Amen. So we're going to start out today. Our lesson today is taken from Proverbs, the second chapter, beginning at verses 1 through 11, the key verse being verse 6. And as I said last week, we will be in Proverbs for the next three more weeks. I think we're in Proverbs, and we will be studying this unit, wisdom. And we see what Solomon, who asked for wisdom at an early age and was granted wisdom above all, we'll see what the wise man had to say about wisdom and today its pursuit. Amen. So before we start, I did ask a question last week. And the question last week was, apart from Proverbs, what other book or books did Solomon write? And that answer was Solomon penned Song of Solomon. He penned Ecclesiastes. And he also contributed to the Psalms in Psalm number 72 and Psalm number 127. The winner for that question is Sister Angie Davis. Again, I will ask a series of questions. The first one to reply with the correct answer in the comment will win a prize that will be given out at a later date. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. And our first question for the day, name the other two writers who contributed to Proverbs. King Solomon wasn't the only one who contributed, even though he contributed most of it. There were two other people who contributed to this book of Proverbs, and if you name them correctly, you will win a prize. Amen?
Amen.
Let's get some background on Proverbs. As we learned from new members class, if you went through the new members class Bible structure, the book of Proverbs falls into the category of the book of books of poetry or wisdom. Let me say that again. Proverbs falls into the category of the books of poetry or wisdom, along with Job, Psalms, Ecclesiastes, and Song of Solomon. The purpose of the book of Proverbs is summed up in Proverbs chapter 1, verses 2, which says, to know wisdom and instruction, to perceive the words of understanding. The theme is found in chapter 1, verses 7, and it reads as thus, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge, but fools despise wisdom and instruction. These two major themes, wisdom and folly, are interwoven and overlapping throughout Proverbs. Wisdom, which includes knowledge, understanding, instruction, discretion, obedience, is built on the fear of the Lord and the words of God. So let me say that again. Wisdom is basically built on the fear of the word and the word of God. Not the word of your cousins, you know, but the word of God. Folly is everything that's opposite of wisdom. As we know, the book of Proverbs is authored by Solomon with contributions from Agar and Lemuel. I believe I just said something. Solomon also penned, as we just went over, Psalm 72 and 127, Ecclesiastes and Song of Solomon. Question number two. How many songs did Solomon compose? Question number two. How many songs did Solomon compose? Along with Proverbs that he spake, he also composed some songs. Amen. Solomon rose to the throne with great promise and privilege and opportunity, primarily because of his father, David. He became king at a relatively early age of 20 and reigned over the unified kingdom for 40 years. So Solomon was the last king of the unified kingdom. Solomon recognized that his youth and inexperience would be a hindrance to his ability to reign over God's people. So what did he do? Glad you asked. He asked God and was granted wisdom that exceeded all others. So Solomon realized his limits, and he asked God to help him. That's a key right there. Somebody needs to realize where they're limited and ask God to help them. Because I believe the Bible declares that in your weakness, he is strong. Amen. And some of us need to be rendered weak to show God's strength. But I digress. Some lesson background. This book of wisdom, Proverbs, is like a parent sitting down with their young child to pass on valuable lessons learned after a lifetime of trials and errors, all for the purpose of preparing the child slash reader for living godly lives in fear of the Lord. In this passage that we're going to look at, Solomon is given instructions to a son as how to obtain wisdom of the Lord. He gives clear details to the son of how to search for wisdom, what to listen for, very important, and what to do with the wisdom once he obtains it. So he's telling the son how to search, what to listen for, listening is important, and what to do with it once he obtains it. Because it's one thing to get some knowledge, it's another thing to do something with it.
Yes, sir.
One of the hardest questions that a person can ask themselves is what's the meaning of life? Philosophers have pondered this question. Many books have been written on the subject. And yet a person can spend their entire lives still never come close to understanding what the meaning of life is. And that, unfortunately, is a person going through life lost. Many times it takes a person well into their adulthood to figure out the meaning or their purpose. Amen? So if we just stay with the Bible and reread this, we don't have to go through that long process. Amen. But consider Job and his discourse on wisdom. Job in Job chapter 28, verses 12 and 20, drop down. Job says, "But where shall wisdom be found? And where is the place of understanding?" Verse 20 says, "Whence then come wisdom? And where is the place of understanding?" Job was trying to figure this out, racking his mind. Job's discourse lets the reader know that no amount of effort, when you read Job, when you read that 28th chapter, that no amount of effort, as vigorous and demanding as mining, will yield God's wisdom. It can't be valued or found in the world. It cannot be bought at any price. No institution that you go to of higher learning. And I recommend it, but you know. You have to get godly wisdom from God. That just makes country sense, woman. So in this lesson, we will learn the value and benefit of wisdom and how to seek it. Question number three. How many total proverbs did Solomon speak? And by the way, these answers are found in your Bible. Amen. Probably somewhere around the first chapter of Proverbs.
Don't give us the answer now.
I try not to.
Open book.
Yeah, open book. Sometimes those are the hardest ones, I found out. Amen. So the lesson, I will look at 3 points. The pursuit of wisdom. I want to look at the provider of wisdom. And I want to look at the benefits of wisdom slash the protection of wisdom. Amen. So when we look at the pursuit of wisdom, here Solomon sits down with his son and it starts out with an if-then scenario. And we've talked about these if-then scenarios. If you do something, then this will be the result. If these actions are obeyed, then it will lead to a reward. Within the five verses are eight verbs used to urge the listener slash the son to take action. He says, listen, treasure, hide, tune your ear, apply, cry out, ask, search, and seek. So that lets you know that this verb lets you know that this pursuit, you have to pursue wisdom. Wisdom won't just jump up on you and you won't get it by just osmosis, by standing around. You have to be active to get wisdom. Such language indicates that the pursuit of wisdom is not to be passive, but passionate. Wisdom is not attained from desire alone. Mm-hmm. But because one listens with intent and purpose, one who desires to be wise and asks for insights, crying out with a sense of urgency, understanding that wisdom value is like that of silver, which was popular in those days. Wisdom is a treasure readily recognizable, but not easily or abundantly accessible to all. Gaining wisdom is not a simple or static task. You got to do something, but it requires constant effort to be uncovered. But the reward for pursuing it leads to one knowing God and understanding what it means to receive Him. And so when you seek wisdom, we see all these benefits that you get, but you have to follow these verbs. It says, my son, if you will receive, it starts out with receive. You have to be willing to receive it. You have to hide it. So that means you have to commit to it. You have to listen for it. And once you hear it, you have to apply it. And I'll say something about that later. Once you listen, hear it, you have to apply it to your heart. Then you have to pursue it. You have to cry out. Last week we talked about wisdom crying out. Now this week it's you crying out for wisdom and lifting your voice, seeking her, searching for her. Then once you do all those things, if you do those things, and let me say this, sometimes we want to shortcut the order. Sometimes we want to cry out before we listen. We want to scream and holler, but we don't understand the situation. There's some folk who screaming and hollering, wonder why police station burned down, wonder why CVS is burning down, but they won't listen to the situation. There's some folk who get it confused and say Colin Kaepernick kneeled because he wasn't patriotic. They're not listening. Drew Brees wasn't listening. You have to listen first and get some understanding. Then you can cry out. Then you can search. You have to receive. And sometimes we shortcut the process or we don't do them in these orders that are here in verses 1 through 4. And once we do that, we gain some understanding. We gain some knowledge. Amen? Mm-hmm. But let me look at the flip side of that, because although Proverbs keeps the reality of suffering in the background and presents a more optimistic view, I want to consider the consequences of going to the world for wisdom, getting wisdom from the world. Amen? Getting wisdom from your boy, your boo, your cousins and them, not getting godly wisdom. And I want to thank Reverend Palmer on Wednesday who helped me out with this, because he made the argument about Joseph in Genesis chapter 42:21. And this is what happens when you don't listen. This is what happens. Genesis chapter 42 verse 21 reads as though, and they said to one another, we are very guilty concerning our brother, in that we saw the anguish of his soul, saw it. And when he besought us, we would not hear or listen. Therefore, this distress has come upon us. And maybe it is a nation hasn't been listening to black people saying black lives matter, our lives matter. We deserve the right to liberty and the pursuit of happiness. We deserve that. And because they have not heard us, now this distress is coming upon the nation. When you don't listen, or when you seek your own wisdom, this is what happens. Thank you, Reverend Palmer, for helping me out considering the flip side of this, of godly wisdom. And Joseph and his brothers, you know the story, they sold him. They wanted to kill him, but and Reuben said, please don't do this. And they didn't listen to Reuben. Well, they halfway listened to Reuben. And now here it is that now they come to a point where they're in jail and their brother's in charge and they're afraid. All because they didn't listen. And I believe the first one says receive or listen. Incline thy ear, receive, and then incline thy ear in listening. We need to do a lot more listening before we do a lot more action. Amen. Thus, wisdom should result in certain actions. Consider James chapter 3, verses 13 to 7. Who is wise and understanding among you? Let them show it by their good life, by their deeds done in humility, that comes from wisdom. But if you harbor bitter envy, selfish ambition in your heart, do not boast about it or deny the truth. Such wisdom does not come from heaven, but is earthly, unspiritual, demonic. For where you have envy and selfish ambition, there you find disorder and every evil practice. But wisdom that comes from heaven is first of all pure, then peace-loving, considerate, submissive, full of mercy, good fruit, impartial, and sincere. This is at the heart of what James says when he shows us what does wisdom look like. So if you want to understand what your wisdom looks like, because of the wisdom or whatever that you have, it should result in something that is pure, peace-loving, considerate, submissive, full of mercy, good fruit, impartial, and sincere. If your actions are that, then I don't believe that you have godly wisdom. You have earthly wisdom, which will lead to destruction. Amen. So that was the pursuit of wisdom. Wisdom is something that we have to pursue. It just doesn't jump up on you. But then you have the provider of wisdom, where we see in verse 6, although wisdom is to be actively sought, it must be understood that God is the only one who gives godly wisdom. That just makes country sense, right? Mm-hmm.
Yes, sir.
The Lord giveth wisdom, where? Out of his mouth. He gives wisdom, and out of his mouth come knowledge and understanding. So that means if he's giving wisdom and God's giving the wisdom, you got to go where God is to get the wisdom. And where did God put the wisdom at? It's in your Bible if you didn't tear it up. So it's in the Bible, wisdom. And I say it again, all the answers to life's questions and problems lie somewhere between Genesis and Revelation. And all we have to do is just read it to figure out. That's where it lies at. It says he lays up sound wisdom for righteousness. And then he also is a buckler, or he'll shield you and guard you and keep it the path of judgment. And he preserves you. He provide, not only will he provide, but he will protect you. You get some added benefits of it. Amen. But then you see the benefits of wisdom. The benefit of attaining wisdom is discernment. Wisdom allows a person to understand what is right, just, and fair. Righteousness, judgment, and equity, King James Version says. And this is what we call the ethical triad. Mm.
The ethical triad.
And I said earlier, wisdom is just not knowing what is right, but it's doing something. Knowing what is right is simply just knowledge. And how many people walking around with knowledge? But if you don't do nothing with knowledge, then you just walking around with it. You have to do something with it. That's why this Christianist life, this Christian movement, this Jesus movement is something active. It's a verb, right? This is something that we must do. So once you get wisdom, you have the benefit and you get understanding. And the earlier it is, like Solomon sat down with his son, the earlier that we sit down with our children and teach them wisdom, they'll have the ability to discern. They'll have the ability. What does discernment mean? It means to make the right decisions. It means being able to understand that a person fleeing from you with their back from does not need to be shot down. Discernment. Godly discernment. But when we have the world's discernment, we just shoot people down and we just do all this. And what happens? Now we have chaos and we reap we reap that chaos which we have sown because we haven't sought godly wisdom. So my takeaway from this is that we must seek godly wisdom and we must start early. And it comes with parents sitting down, teaching and telling their sons and their daughters, seeking godly wisdom so that they can grow up and understand this ethical triad of right, fair, to understand righteousness, just, and fair. Amen. That is my time for today. Our lesson for next week is going to be from Proverbs chapter 8, verses 8 through 14, then 17 through 21, and the key verse being, and the key verses 10 through 11. So at this time, let me introduce our praise team who will give us a selection, and then we'll hear from Pastor Moore with a word from the Lord. Thank you and God bless.
Jehovah is your name. Jehovah is your name. Jehovah is your name. Jehovah is your name. Mighty warrior, great in battle, Jehovah is your name. Jehovah is your name. We bless your name, God. Jehovah is your name. You alone are worthy. Jehovah, Jehovah is your name.
We greet you once again in that name that is above every name, and we are delighted to be here once again to share a word. Thank you, Deacon Simpson, for our church school lesson. And then we want to thank our praise team, who's done a wonderful job today, and thank our technicians, lead technician Deacon Derek Green, for putting all of this together and working with all of the pieces and putting them together. And we see the SMZ band this morning for the first time in a long time. Oh, what a refreshing sound to hear! To hear the band coming together. And we announced on Wednesday night we had one to join on last week, Sister Sandy Johnson Mack. We want to give a shout out to her once again this morning and welcome her to the Second Mount Zion family. And we will be starting church orientation with her on tomorrow night. Why don't you say amen?
Amen.
Bow with me for a moment of prayer. God, we thank you now for this opportunity and for this privilege of sharing your word. We ask now that you would break up the foul ground, that the seed of the gospel might fall upon good soil, that the harvest will truly be great in the masterful and in the marvelous name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
All right, our text today comes from John chapter 13. And actually verses 1 through 15. And if you don't mind, let me just read all of those verses. You know, when I read long, I preach short.
Bless you.
Now before the feast, 13:1. Now before the feast of the Passover, when Jesus knew that his hour had come and he should depart from this world to the Father, having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them unto the end. And supper being ended, the devil having already put it into the heart of Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, to betray him, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hand, that he had come from God and was going to God, he arose from supper, laid aside his garment, took up a towel, and girded himself. After that, he pours water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel wherewith he was girded. And he came to Simon Peter, and Peter said, Lord, are you washing my feet? Jesus answered and said to him, what I am doing, you do not understand now, but you will understand afterward. Peter said to him, you shall never wash my feet. Jesus answered him, if I do not wash you, you have no part with me. Simon Peter said, Lord, not my feet only, but my hand and my head. Jesus said unto him, he who is bathed need only to wash his feet, but is completely clean. And you are clean, but not all of you. For he knew who would betray him. Therefore he said, you are not all clean. So when he had washed their feet, taken his garment, sat down again, he said unto him, do you know what I have done unto you? You call me Master and Lord, and you say, well, for so I am. If then I'm your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you ought to wash one another's feet. For I have given you an example that you should do as I have done to you. The word of God. And for a few moments today, we want to talk about motives for service. Uh-huh. What is your motive for serving, or what is your motive for doing whatever you do? As Deacon Simpson was teaching the lesson, I was thinking about the crowds and the protests. And some folk are protesting. Their motive is that we need to be heard, and we want to be heard, And so they have a peaceful protest. But then there are others who are motivated by greed because they see an opportunity to take advantage, to take something that don't belong to them or to destroy their own neighborhood. They are motivated by the wrong things. And I challenge each and every one of us this morning to check your motive for doing whatever you're doing. You need wisdom to discern, and particularly when you are in a crowd, you need to discern who is with you with the cause and who are not with you. Because not everybody is there for the same reason. And when I come to this text and when I look at this text today, Jesus had a short time. He was on his way to the cross and his time was limited, but he had a lot to teach his disciples and a short time to do it. And he picked one of the most important events in the Jewish life, and that was the Feast of the Passover, the Passover feast, when he would have everybody's attention. It's kind of like this morning, one of the most important events in the life of the church is the Lord's Supper. In fact, about it, there's only one other ordinance that he left on record for the church.
Yeah.
It is one of two ordinance that he left on record for the church, and it is the Lord's Supper. And so as we reflect on the Lord's Supper, we need to check our motives, and as we focus on the Lord's Supper, the Lord ought to have our attention.
That's right.
What is it that motivates you to listen this morning, that motivates you to worship this morning? Are you motivated by a position? Are you motivated by power? Are you motivated by authority? You want to rule over somebody? And Jesus had ordered that he be in the upper room alone with his disciples. Because he wanted them he had some things that he needed to focus them on before he leave this world. They needed to know some things because he was going to leave the church in their hands. But unfortunately, like many of us, according to Luke chapter 22, verse 24, the disciples was focusing on other things. You want to know what they were focusing on?
What's that, Reverend?
They were focusing on who going to be the greatest in the kingdom. Mm-hmm. Jesus had told them that when he instituted the Lord's Supper, he had told them that I will not drink it anymore with you until I come into my kingdom and we drink it anew. And in their mind is, who's going to be the greatest in the kingdom? And so Luke 22:44 said they were arguing about. Now there was also a dispute among them as to which of them would be considered the greatest in the kingdom. Jesus is focusing on service, and they are focusing on who's going to be in charge, who's going to be next to Jesus. Mark 10:37 says, they said to him, James and John, James and John,
they
came to Jesus and said, Jesus, we want you to do something for us. And Jesus said, what is it that you want? And they said, grant one of us to sit on the right and the other on the left. Even though they walked with Jesus, they was motivated by a position. And they was motivated by power and authority. They wanted to rule next to Jesus. And Jesus knew what was on their mind. And he had a long ways to go and a lot to teach them and a short time to make it. Listen to the text. It said, now before the feast of the Passover, when they would get together and when they should have been focusing on Jesus, who is the Lamb of God, Jesus knew that his hour was come. Jesus knew that his hour had come. He didn't have much time left on the earth. He knew that his hour was come, that he should depart out of the world unto the Father. And so there are several factors that drove Jesus to wash the disciples' feet.
Let's see.
The first one that drove him to wash the disciples' feet is, I don't have much time left.
Yeah.
My hour has come. And the second is, what drove him and what motivated him to wash the disciples' feet was his love for people. The underlining and the principal motivation of Jesus was love. His love for people. Look at the text. He knew that his hour had come, that he should depart out of the world unto the Father, having, there it is, loved his own who were in the world. And look at the text. The text says he loved them unto the end. See, love is not something that you can turn on and turn off when you get ready.
Yes, sir. Say it, Pastor.
That ain't love.
What's love, right?
Love is an all the way thing.
All the way.
He loved, the text says he loved them unto the end. See, love does not depend on the person who's being loved, but love moves out of the individual who is the lover. You see, and the Apostle Paul said, love doesn't hold no record.
Oh, you said something there.
We love folk conditionally. We love it as long as you do this, as long as you do that, I love you. But Jesus loved them unto the end. Let's see who Jesus loved.
Let's see.
A crooked tax collector.
Uh-oh.
His own.
Say what?
Matthew, a crooked tax collector. His own. Yeah. Judas, who would betray him. Even though he wasn't his own, he gave him the same love and opportunity that he gave the rest. He never stopped appealing to Judas. He loved them until the end. A culture conscious Nathaniel.
Yeah.
He loved him until the end. Can any good thing come out of Nazareth? He loved him until the end. A foul mouthed fisherman like Peter,
call the roll.
He loved him unto the end. A hot-tempered, fly-off-the-handle,
look out, James and John, he loved them unto the end. Now, I don't know exactly who's watching me this morning, but put your name there and think about your own faults. But yet, our foreparents will say, he looked beyond my faults and saw my need. Put your name there and say, he loves me until the end. He loves me unconditionally. And supper being ended, the devil, and I said there was three things that motivated Jesus and drove him to wash the disciples' feet. We talked about his hour was near. We talked about his love for his own. But he was driven by his enemy because he knew that his enemy was going to soon strike. He knew his enemy. He had the wisdom and the discernment and knew his enemies. Look at this. He says, supper being ended and the devil having already put it into the heart of Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, to betray him. He knew his enemies. Sometimes you got to know your enemies. You got to have enough wisdom and discernment to know your enemies. And that's how come, Deacon Simpson, you got to listen. Sometimes your enemies will tell you who they are if you just listen to them.
That's right.
You can listen to folk talk and kind of tell where they are. You can listen to what folk talk and tell where they get it from, where it's coming from. Let me go on and preach and stop meddling. Let me just go on. He knew his enemies.
You're going to help somebody.
Yeah, he knew his enemy. They sitting around motivated. They were motivated by the wrong thing. And Jesus took on himself the ministry of humiliation. And when you are motivated by love, even though you might be humiliated, and one of the greatest things in the world today is humility.
Yeah.
Because when you are humble, you can take some stuff.
Oh Lord.
That's how come. Folk are not afraid to pull out of a gun and shoot you these days.
Lord, have mercy.
That's how come we have so much shooting in our city, because nobody don't want to be humiliated. Don't you disrespect me. Don't you diss me.
Yeah.
You looked at me the wrong way. You were talking about me. Jesus took up the ministry of humiliation. And through his humiliation, he demonstrated, and since Jesus was the one doing it, and he's Lord of lords and King of kings, Jesus demonstrates for us royal service.
Look out, brother.
Royal service is always motivated by love for people. And let me just say a word about ministry. Ministry is meeting the needs of people.
Yeah.
Yeah. If what you call your ministry, if Jesus and his concerns are not at the center of your ministry, it is not a ministry, it's an activity.
That's right.
And a lot of us, we get wrapped up in activities and we never minister.
You said something, Reverend.
That word ministry has become popular in most recent years. Because everybody changed their auxiliary and their clubs. They changed it to a ministry, but they didn't change the content of the activity.
Yeah, content.
The activity. Jesus must be the center of any ministry. And if Jesus is not the center, it is not a ministry. It is just another activity.
Yeah.
And how often is that folk that can get wrapped up in the activity? Because some of us, we can't wait to get back to the church so we can get involved in activities.
Oh, Lord, Reverend.
Yeah. And so Jesus demonstrates to us the way to royal service, the way to royalty. He says to his disciples, the way to royalty is service. You don't get some stuff just because it's your time, just because you think it's your time, or just because you think it's my time or my opportunity. He says the way to royalty is service, and not only is the way to royalty service, the way to greatness is ministry. The way you become great is you minister to the needs of people. Jesus, look at the text.
I'm looking.
Jesus, knowing that the Father had put all things into his hand and that he had come from God and was on his way back to God, he rises from supper, lays aside his garments, takes a towel, and girded himself around his waist like a common servant. He did not put the towel on his paps like the high priest. He girded himself around his waist like a servant, and Jesus was meeting the needs of the servant that was not in the room.
You made that plain, Reverend.
Because in Jerusalem, the streets were dusty like they are down south, you know, like they were down south.
Yeah, in the lane.
And back up in the lane when there was no hard road. And they wore open-toe sandals. And when they walked into a house, there was a basin there for poor folk, there was a basin there, and they had to take off their sandals and wash their feet because they didn't want to track up and put dust all through the house. And that would be comparable for somebody today. You ever been to somebody's house and you got to take off your shoes at the door?
Yep.
Because they didn't want you to put dust all through their house. But the rich folk, there was a servant that was always provided to wipe the feet of the guests. And the disciples was in the room, and they were looking at each other, talking about, I ain't washing no Peter's feet. Lord. And John said, I sure ain't washing Judas' feet. I ain't washing nobody's feet.
Yeah.
And Jesus watching all of these dynamics going on, and they jockeying for position and trying to get a position. They're motivated and power struck. And starstruck, you know how some folk are starstruck? They can only perform when they're out front.
Lord, have mercy.
Come on, Reverend.
I don't want to talk about nobody, but I'm just talking about what I'm talking about.
Yeah, just say it, Reverend, just say it.
Yeah. They're starstruck. They can perform well when they're out front, but when they're not out front, they just lay back in the back. In fact, about it, if they're not out front, they may not even show up.
Oh, don't say that, Reverend.
And Jesus watching all of these dynamics. And Jesus did not say a word, got up, laid off his garment, pours water into a basin, girded himself with a towel because he was motivated by love and ministry. And ministry is meeting a need. And he met the needs of the servant that was not in the room. When he gets to Peter, he didn't start with Peter. But by the time he got to Peter, Peter said, Lord, are you washing my feet? And Jesus said, you don't understand what I'm doing right now, but you understand later on because you got to go the same way. And Peter said, you never shall wash my feet. And then he says to Peter,
What'd he say?
If I don't wash you, you will have no part with me. And as one thing about it, now Peter wanted to be a part of the Jesus movement. He said, not my hands and not my feet only, but wash my hands, wash my head, wash me all over, because I wanna be next to you. He still was thinking wrong, because if Jesus just washed everybody else's feet, and if he washed me all over, that means I must be next to him. And so he said, you just watch. He was going beyond what all of the rest of the disciples had gone. And so he said, just wash me all over.
All over.
Yeah.
Jesus, see, and whenever you read John's gospel, John's gospel is more spiritual than the other gospel. So he not only tells you physically what Jesus was doing, but spiritually what Jesus was doing. He said, unless you accept me, unless you've been washed in the blood of the Lamb, unless you've been born again and have accepted me as personal Lord and Savior, and once you are saved, what he was telling Peter, you don't have to be saved all over again, but there are some areas in your life that gets dirty as we walk in this world, and that's how come you have to repent often and allow the Lord to deal with the sin area.
Yeah.
Cause there's a whole lot of folk, they just say, Lord, forgive me for my sin. Well, no, that's no good. Sin. Because you already know you have sinned. But what about Lord, work on my lying tongue? You be more specific. You are a liar, and you know you need to repent. Well, tell the Lord, I'm lying. I need you to work on this lying tongue of mine.
Come on, Reverend.
Lord, I'm mean, and I've been holding grudges. I need you to work on this holding grudges in my area. Lord, I drank too much. I need you to work on that desire for liquor, whatever it is. Name the sin.
Yeah, name it.
Yeah, just don't say forgive me for my sin, because I know you. Everybody knows they've already sinned.
Yes, that's right.
And so, what about that area? He says it's only your feet need to be cleansed, and the spiritual meaning behind that is that you've got some areas in your life that you need to allow the Lord to deal with. And so what Jesus was demonstrating is that royalty, the way to royalty is service, and the way to greatness is ministry, and watch this, and the way to power is humility. If you want power, learn how to be humble. And the way to position is service. Jesus served, and he has a position now at the right hand of the Father. He was humble, and now he has not only the right hand, his position, but he has power. You know what he said when he got up after he'd already served, and after he finished the work that the Lord gave him to do, he said, I got all.
How much?
Power in my hand. The way to power, if you want power, learn humility.
Yeah.
A lot of us can't stand to be, or even think that we've been humiliated. You diss me. You embarrass me.
That's right.
You are focusing on the wrong thing. Yeah. The prerequisite for serving is that you got to be born again. Not only must you be washed, but you got to continually, you got to continually be cleansed. And that's why we're going to observe the Lord's Supper in a few moments.
That's right.
Because we know that we've done something since the last 30 days, and we need to repent and get it out to the Lord so that he can deal with that sin area. Not just forgive me of all of my sins. Well, name some of them so he can begin to knock them off the list one by one. And after you get this one under control, then he can move to the next one. And then look what he says. Look what Jesus says. He said, you don't even know what I've done to you. And he asked the question, do you know what I've done unto you? He said, you call me Lord and teacher, and so I am. King James said, you call me master and Lord, and so I am. Watch this. He says, I was master before I served. Uh-huh. While I was serving,
yeah.
I was Lord and master. And now that I've taken my seat again, guess what?
What? What's that?
I'm still Lord and Master.
Yeah.
What's the word here today? Jesus says when you're motivated by love and you serve, he says you never lose when you learn how to serve. Yeah. Just because I'm the pastor doesn't mean I can't pick up no paper.
That's right.
Doesn't mean I can't run the vacuum cleaner.
Say what?
Doesn't mean that I can't do some work.
Yeah, help Vicky.
Because they call me pastor if I serve. And when I'm in the pulpit, I'm still pastor. Jesus says, now that I've taken my seat again, I'm still Lord and Master. You don't lose when you learn how to serve. And you have the right motivation. That's the meaning of his service. But then, there is the reason. And I'll conclude with the reason that he served.
Uh-huh.
The reason he says, I don't have a long time. And I had to give you an object lesson. And the reason is in verse 15.
Let's see.
He says, I have given you an example. And I've given you an example, and you got to do to others what I've done unto you. When we learn how to serve, we drive folk to repentance and openness so that they can come to the Lord and be washed in the blood of the Lamb.
Uh-huh. Sweeten it, Reverend.
Because you can't really serve the Lord.
Yeah.
Until you've been washed in the blood of the Lamb.
Uh-huh.
Listen. The hymn writer says,
what'd he say?
What can wash away my sins?
Nothing.
Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again?
What?
Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Yeah, move, Reverend.
And I don't know about you, but I'm motivated.
Uh-huh.
By the love of God.
Yeah.
Because it wasn't me that first loved him, but he first loved me.
Yes, sir.
And I love the Lord because he looked beyond my faults.
Yeah, what else?
And he saw my very needs.
Yeah.
And so I'm motivated by his love to meet the needs of people. And so I'm going to serve until 7 days are over.
Yes, sir.
Yes, Lord. I'm going to serve until every cell in my body cry out, it's finished. And if you really want to have a position, learn how to serve. And if you really want power, learn how to serve. Because look at Jesus. He took on the ministry of humiliation. Now, yes, Lord, the record is that he laid his royal diadem on the streets of glory and came and entered history through the back door.
Yes,
and he was born a baby just like you and I. He was absolutely God, and he was the God man, but he became a baby. Now,
That's humiliation. He humbled himself and was born in a cold, dusty, dirty stable where no attending physician, nor compassionate nurse was on duty. He was born in a mule trough. In other words, he was born in a stable. That's humiliation. And then he didn't have an entourage like the normal king. He just only had 12 men, and one of them defaulted. Yes, Lord. But he tabernacled on the streets of Jerusalem. Yes, Lord. He didn't have a horse, a warrior horse, to ride into Jerusalem. He had a broken down old donkey, and he rode into Jerusalem, not as a warrior and not as a king. He humbled himself. And then I heard the word said, the way to real power is humility. They humiliated him. They whipped him all night long. They spat on him. They put a crown of thorns on his head. They humiliated him. But after a while, and by and by, he said to the Father, I finished the work that you've given me to do. And then he bowed his head in the locks of his shoulder and then gave up the ghost. Hey, hey. And they put him down in a grave. But on the third day, I told you, power, a power position is through humiliation. Hey, hey. When he stepped up on the third day, I heard him say that I got all power, power in my hand, and tabernacle on the earth for 50 more long days. But then after a while, he released the dynamic atoms from his body, took the wings of the cloud, went on back to glory, and sat down at the right hand of the Father. Because he served, he got a position at the right hand of the Father. And every now and then, when I stumble and fall, and the faith tell the Father, give him another chance, because I died for him. What's your motivation for service? Power and position doesn't come by chance. You've got to humble yourself. Jesus says to the disciples and to all believers, he said, I have given you an example that you gotta do, must do as I have done unto you. I'm talking to somebody today. If Jesus could look beyond your faults, then you ought to be able to look beyond somebody else's fault and minister unto the needs of people. Ministry is about meeting needs. Listen to the Apostle Paul. In Romans chapter 1, verse 1, he says, I am a servant of the Lord and Jesus Christ, and I've been appointed and an apostle. Servants don't have no rights, but only responsibilities.
That's right.
You don't have a choice when you learn how to serve. You meet the needs of other people. And your motivation for service ought to be not because I love the position, not because I love power, but because I love people. Jesus was motivated because he loved people, and he loved his own unto the end. The question remains, and the challenge is to you today, and you can put it on Facebook. You can put this challenge on Facebook.
Yeah.
What is it that's motivating you to serve? And if you're not motivated by meeting the needs of people,
you have the wrong motivation. Door to church is open. The invitation to church membership and Christian discipleship, the opportunity is yours, and Jesus is extending an invitation to you, just as he did all of the other disciples, just as he did even Judas. He invited Judas. He extended an invitation to him for 3 years, just like he did all the rest. And he's inviting you to come unto him and be motivated by his example. And his example was an example of love. He washed the disciples' feet, his own. Not one of those disciples was without issues. All of them had issues.
Oh.
But he called them his own. I don't care what your issue is today. Jesus will accept you as his very own if you can repent and say with your heart, I believe that God has raised Jesus from the dead and I want to be saved. You can accept the Lord right where you are. And if there is one who desired to have the Lord on your side, you see, the devil wanted Peter, but he got Judas. Jesus can redeem you. And if there be one today who wants to accept Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior, all you got to do is just call the church. Call that number that Sandy called on last week, and we made contact with her. And I said, and I say again, if you call the church on tomorrow, I will personally give you a call, and we can talk about your salvation and start the process of the right motivation. God bless you, and heaven smile upon you. And now, all of us are motivated by the love of Jesus. Because what did Jesus do? He shed his own precious blood out on a hill called Calvary.
Yeah.
And we are coming together today because we've been focusing on Jesus, and what a good time. It was on that large, dark Thursday evening when Jesus had gathered into that large upper room with his disciples and the cross loomed heavily in his path. It was there that night that he instituted the Lord's Supper. And at supper that night, he took the bread and he broke it and said, "This do in remembrance of me." Let us all eat together. And in like manner, he took the cup and said, "This is the blood of the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you." And we know that without the shedding of blood, that there can be no remission of sin. There can be no forgiveness of sin. If Jesus was not motivated by the love to go to Calvary and shed his blood, we could not be forgiven. But because he shed his blood, we can be forgiven. And then the Apostle Paul gave us further instruction and said, "Let a man examine himself, not to see if I've sinned, but since I've sinned, I need to get it out before the Lord and allow the Lord to deal with me, that I may continue in this walk and be motivated so that God can get glory out of my life." Amen, and God bless you. Dean Green is going to close us out. Thank you for watching.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, it's once again that we come before you first just to thank you, Father, We thank you for this morning, Father, allowing us to get up, Father. We thank you for allowing us to put some clothes in our back, Father. We thank you for allowing us to come out, Father. And we thank you, Father, for these remote services that we've been having. Father, we thank you for our pastor, Father, for although we change scenery, Father, he still brings us the word daily, Father.
Yeah.
He still feeds his flock, Father. We thank you for that challenging word that he's given us today, Father. Our motive for service, Father. My prayer is, Father, that our motive for service is not for the love of power, not for the love of position, but, Father, for the love of people, Father.
Yeah.
We thank you, Father, for your ultimate example that you left on record, Father, and Jesus, Father. For in John 3:16, Father, you said, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever shall believe on him, whosoever may be black, may be white, may be Asian, may be Korean, Father. Father, whosoever shall believe on him shall have everlasting life, Father." So, Father, right now we just lift up your people right now. For, Father, right now we're hurting. Father, we stand for various things, Father, but one thing that we can all agree on, Father, is that we need you right now. So, Father, we ask that you just move in a mighty special way, Father. We ask that you just meet our needs, Father. We ask that you just continue to guide, strengthen, and direct us, Father. Father, my prayer is that you just continue to keep us, Father, until we all meet again. All these blessings we do ask in the majestic name of Jesus the Christ. Amen. Go in peace and serve.
You were born our worthy, Jehovah, Jehovah.